National Research Center for Banana Trichy. He is born in 1966 from Coimbatore, and he did his BSc, MSc from TNAU Coimbatore, and a PhD from IRI, this department only. His area of interest are basically the molecular characterization of viruses, development of on-site diagnostic kits, biotechnological approaches of virus disease management. And he has received a number of awards, Jira Sandhi Award, GST Lockheed Martin, second GP Award 2015. He is a fellow of Indian Phytopathological Society, Indian Virological Society, and a fellow of National Academy of Biological Sciences. And he has also received the Hari Om Trust, Hari Om Ashram Trust Award. He is a fellow of AIPUB. He is also a FAO consultant, and he has also received a Best Scientist Award, besides also other awards. And his actually main contribution is development of diagnostics of banana viruses. So banana, actually a lot of viruses are there. So he has developed diagnostic of all the viruses, and these diagnostics are also available for all the stakeholders. So I request Dr. Silva Rajan, today's guest, please proceed.
Thank you, Dr. Pant. Friends, I am going to talk today on protein-based diagnosis and its application in plant virus diagnosis. So I think you would have heard wonderful lectures from all our colleagues from IRI plant virology about the virus and different approaches in diagnostics you would have heard. And genome based and different kind of detection diagnostics you would have also might be doing in the practical, the laboratory, at laboratories. And here I am going to talk about protein based diagnostics. And you know, all of you know about the viruses causes a very serious loss to the crop, and there are viruses which may not cause serious yield losses, but there are viruses which cause irreversible damage to the crop. Like, take an example of banana bunchitop virus, and would have all known about the banana bunchitop virus. Once it infects, it will lead to kill the plant, and it will not give you any yield. There are many such examples, but there are many viral diseases which gives some yield, like papaya ring spot virus. You would have seen the papaya fruits with the ring spot in the shops, you know. So, and again, sometimes serious cases, even papaya, there won't be any papaya fruits in the infected plant. So, it's fight between the virus and the plant, and the always the virus wants to make the plant to survive, because the virus has to survive, being an obligate parasite, okay. So, coming to the protein, there are a lot of, I think, yield losses data are available. And there was a report of around 50 billion euros loss worldwide every annually due to plant viruses. And moreover, not only the yield loss, but also nutritional quality goes down, and short shelf life in case of fruits and many other commodities, and loss of income to the growers. And you look at the virus, you know, you would have seen the virus particles. I don't know how many of you have seen the virus particles under an electron microscope or even in a picture. What you see a structure like a rigid rod and flexuous rods, or a isometric particle of icosahedral particles, and a different kind of particles you would have seen in the books at least. But what you see is a shape of a virus. We are not seeing in the genome in this, isn't it? But virus is very simply a genome packed packed by or coated by a protein. So only two things are there in a virus. One is genome, which is packed perfectly by its code protein. But where from this code protein comes? Where from this protein comes? So you can see in case of genome, if you look at, there are a lot of positive sense RNA. That is nothing but messenger RNA. Messenger RNA itself is a genome of most of the plant viruses. But there are single-stranded DNA as a genome, and there are double-stranded DNA as a genome. There are circular molecules. There are circular molecules of genome, like Brana Banchita virus, it has got a single-stranded circular molecule. In case of Brana's badenoviruses, like cauliflower mosaic virus and all, it's a double-stranded circular genome. And there are viruses which has got negative sense RNA as a genome. So there are different kinds of genomes are there, but everywhere there is a small part of a genome codes for code protein. That gives the structural structural part of the virus, without which it cannot survive. The structural part of the virus, the shape and everything is given by that. But you know, genome is only one molecule in a virus. In a virus particle, what you see is only one molecule of genome is present. But whereas the protein, what you see, the protein, a bricks of protein, it's not a single molecule, you know. It's not a single molecule. In case of tobacco mosaic virus, what you see, every subunits will have a 158 amino acids, and there will be a lot of subunits packed in such a way a single molecule is made into a virus particle, isn't it? In case of Brana Banchita virus, 60 subunits are there. In icosahedral isometric particle, there are 60 subunits, like 60 bricks, you can say. All 60 bricks are arranged in such a way that it just covers the entire genome, isn't it? So the protein is more important for its survival. Okay. So what you see here, most of the viral, if you look at, it's a 60 to 95% of the virion is made of a protein, and nucleic acid is only 5 to 40%. Only 5 to 40%. And in case here you can see this table, tobacco mosaic virus, the nucleic acid is only 5% of its particle. 95% is the protein. Okay. As I said, it's not a single protein. It's a multiples of same subunits it makes a particle. In case of cucumber mosaic virus, like it's 18% is nucleic acid and 82% protein. In TRSV, tobacco rattle, this virus, you see 40% is nucleic acid. So genome and protein, if you see the ratio it goes. But you know, you want to detect a virus means whether it's live, are you detecting a live virus or a dead virus. If you just detect a protein without any genome inside in it, it's not live, isn't it? If you're detecting a virus which is containing both the protein and genome, then it is okay. You can detect the either virus or its protein. So why do we do this virus diagnosis? Why at all it's more important for virus diagnosis? And you know, we are all curious about the symptoms. Most of the plant pathologists, I think all of you are plant pathologists. Whenever you walk down any street or anywhere where vegetation is there, you'll be watching the plant whether it is showing any mosaic or any spot. Because most of our pathologists would like to know what is this disease, how it looks, and whether it is colluted trichome, whether acerola is there, or something like, you know, whether mosaic or ring spot. Something we all curious to know about the symptoms and relate with the pathogen. Whether it's a fungi or phytoplasma or bacteria. So all these things we always will be looking at, especially when you go into the field, anywhere. We'll be looking whether visually can you diagnose. That's what you will be looking, most of the plant pathologists. Okay, we are all being called as a plant doctors, you know. So we will be always keeping an eye to look and diagnose the disease by eyes. And whether one or more viruses present, you know, there are multiple virus infects a single crop. Simultaneously also you can see. So can we distinguish those viruses just by visually? It may not be possible. Then grower also want to say, because you know growers, the growers, the farmers, poor farmers, you know, they want to always see what I can spray, they will be telling. Because most of the fungal pathogens, we have got fungicides to spray. Bacterial, again, there are bactericides and antibiotics to spray. For virus, there are no such things, you know. So, but the farmers will be asking, what can I spray to control this mosaic? What can I spray for papaya ring spot virus? If you say some nutrient, if you go to the field, and there are many people, they recommend nutrients for virus control. And there are many products in the biological products available in the shops for controlling virus disease. Of course, there are no scientific background for such recommendations to control the viruses using such this one. So viruses, where did the virus come from? Can the source be reduced, weeds or seeds? Where from it comes actually? All of a sudden, we see a bunchy top in a place they would have not seen for 10 years. All of a sudden, they see a bunchy top. And they used to really astonish where from it came. Just in the backyard, they grow a banana. At the end, they see a bunchy top. They see where from it came. And people are not aware there are vectors which can transmit a virus. And sometimes a seed material can transmit. There are seed-borne viruses. So those things people are, especially growers, are not aware to take this one. So how viruses are transmitted? Is it mechanically or seed-borne? So there are different methods. So what are the applications of this diagnosis? That we would be going to see. What are the different methods of diagnosis are there? And especially aiming at the proteins, okay? I am not going to deal anything on genome-targeted diagnostics. I am going to deal mostly on the protein-targeted, that especially, again, code protein-targeted. And most of you are students of plant pathology and PhD holders here. All of you are doing PhD, I hope. So here you would have already gone through the lectures of, you would have read also, and you would have had, it can be an interactive also when I talk. So what are the different methods we adopt for serological based diagnostics I will be going to deal? I will be dealing very basics. You can, very, very basic. Sometimes I am going to talk about repetitively because I want to make you sure that something you learn out of this talk on the protein-based diagnostics. Okay. So what are the different diagnostics, biological assays? You know, all of you, I think nowadays no one does the biological assays. We have to take a plant and crush it and sap transmission, you do it and see whether it is you are getting local lesions or systemic infection. And this normally people now not following, but straight away they go for genome-based PCR and other techniques. But this is very, very important to see whether it is mechanically transmissible or not. To know that, you have to have the indicator plants and you can do. And physical assays, immediately, whenever we see, immediately the samples will be sent to a place, a laboratory, where electron microscope is there. And we want to know immediately some structure of virus is there or not there in the given sample. So we will be knowing physically, we want to see whether virus particle is present in a infected plant or suspected plant, we want to see. So a method, physically we are seeing a virus is electron microscope. I think Dr. Pant gave a wonderful lecture on electron microscopy a few days back here. And the next comes serological assays, then comes nucleic acid assays. Serological assays, this is only protein targeted, serological, all of you know about that. Then nucleic acid based. Nucleic acid assays now of late, past two decades, we talk about genome targeted approaches like PCR and its many other different formats of PCR. And the protein based, when you look at precipitation test, precipitation test was the one in 70s people used to do, precipitation test. Then agglutination test. Then comes enzyme-linked immunosorbent assay. Then came dot immunobinding assay. Then tissue blot immunoassay. Then Western blot assay. Then immunosorbent electron microscopy, wherein both serological and electron microscopy is combined. Then lateral flow immunoassay, you know about dipstick, that is for on-site diagnostics. You know about the point of care diagnostics is very common in human disease diagnostics. You had to go to the patient instead of the patient comes to a diagnostic lab. So that's the thing is needed in case of human viral diagnostics, and even many zoonotic diseases where this point of care diagnostics is more important, wherein the serological things are applied for diagnostic kit development. Then microsphere immunoassay. I don't know, many of you may not be knowing about this microsphere immunoassay. I'll be telling you about microsphere immunoassay, very interesting one. And nucleic acid based, though it is not my talk, this also there are good, like nucleic acid spot hybridization. Before PCR, we used to do often this nucleic acid spot hybridization, that is like southern blot analysis. Then polymerase chain reaction, it came. Then again RT-PCR, real-time PCR, nested. There are different formats of genome targeted approaches, immunocaptured PCR, where the antibodies are used to capture the virus, then do the PCR, because sometimes the virus titer might be very, very less. So wherein we had to capture the virus, then do the PCR, that gives a more sensitivity is increased when you combine. Immunoprecipitation PCR, then rolling circle amplification. Then, you know, rolling circle amplification also, you know, we all use this PCR everywhere. Are we not using any protein there? We are all using the protein. There are many enzymes. Polymerase is a protein. So there are many proteins. Without protein, there are no diagnosis. Though we are targeting genome to amplify, but we need a protein to amplify. So polymerase is nothing but a protein, you know. So loop-mediated isothermal amplification, then recombinase polymerase amplification. Recombinase polymerase also, I can't say technically it's a protein based. Then next generation sequencing is another technique, and recently, you know, nanopore sequencer is widely used for plant virus diagnostics, and you can do on-site diagnostics of viruses. And again, I am repeating here, you know, this is again precipitation test, agglutination, ELISA, DIBA, TIBA, tissue blot immunoassay, Western blot, microsphere, LFA, dipstick, IP-PCR, IC-PCR, ISEM. So there are many, many methods, and each method, you cannot apply all the methods. You have to choose which methods to apply and which methods you have to apply, where you have to apply, whether can you apply a method in the field itself. There are methods which you can apply in the field. There are methods where you need not to have any knowledge. Any farmer can use such methods. And only some methods, you need some laboratory environment. Some methods, you need not have such environment. Okay. Coming to the serological test for plant virus diagnostics, you know, anti-serum. And I know how many of you handled and raised polyclonal anti-serum, I don't know. And how many of you are virologists, I don't know. But this is, you know, if you are telling serological image, you need what you need. You need an anti-serum. And you, for anti-serum raising, what do you want? You need an antigen. What is antigen? Antigen can be anything. It can be a protein or it can be any molecule. Okay. Any foreign body, when you are injecting into the warm-blooded animal, it will give you an antibodies. Okay. It will give you a serum. And in anti-serum, you will have the antibodies. Antibodies can be many things. It can be IgM, IgA. So different kind. But the most one is immunoglobulin, IgG we call. Okay. So, anti-serum is very important to do serological assay for any virus. And, you know, there are a lot of things like tobacco mosaic virus is highly immunogenic, they say. Some viruses are very highly immunogenic. Banana bunchita virus is not an immunogenic, they say. What is immunogenic? What is not immunogenic? Okay. The protein which has to have good antigenic determinant. If it is not having a good antigenic determinant, you will not get a good anti-sera, will not get a good immunoglobulin to put into use in the ELISA. That's what it's very important. A protein should be very good antigenic determinant it should have to get a high titer anti-serum, and you can apply for diagnostics. And if you look at the virologists in this, most of the RNA containing means RNA is a genome. The viruses having RNA is a genome has got good antigenic determinant and highly immunogenic. Most of the RNA viruses has got a good immunogenic capability. And if you look at most of the diagnostic kit, ELISA kits, most of the virus like cucumber mosaic virus, potato virus, Y, there are many viruses wherein RNA is a genome, you get a good quality antisera. But for DNA viruses, Gemini virus, you see, it's very poor antisera you get. Banana bunchitop, you get very poor antisera. And banana streak, badna virus, again, it's very poor. So most of the DNA viruses are not good immunogenic. I don't know the reasons, but that is the fact. So we need to have a purified virus to do this, to raise an antiserum. So purification of a virus, if you want, you have to have a good laboratory wherein you have to have a high-speed centrifuge, ultra-centrifuge. Then you have to have a... So purification of virus is very needed to raise a polyclonal antiserum. So in polyclonal antiserum, you immunize a rabbit, mostly rabbit, because most of the plant viruses, rabbit has been used, widely used to raise antisera for most of the plant viruses. Of course, mice also being used, but mice gives a very quite low quantity of antisera. So once you inject a purified virus into the rabbit, then you get an antiserum. The antiserum, once you collect and you can purify the IgG, immunogamma globulin, and you can also do conjugate. There are many things you can do with the antisera once you obtain. And you know, once you inject into the rabbit or any warm-blooded animal, the B cells, B lymphocytes, gives you the antibodies. This B lymphocytes, it gives you the antibodies and it circulates into the system of the animal. Okay. Once that antigen is not there, it will go and sit in the spleen. It will be hibernating in the spleen. So again, when you are injecting sometimes after a long, long time, again you are getting same antigen, then immediately it will be activated. The B cells will be activated and again it will capture and it will circulate and it will be neutralizing the antigen. That's what our body, our human body or any warm-blooded animal does the job. So when we want to antiserum, just inject this one and give a, again next week and again keep a continuous injection schedule, then you give a booster injection and at the end you just bleed the animal using a different techniques, like you can bleed the venal, you can even heart puncture methods are there where you can take without affecting the animal, you can take the blood, then you can, if you settle down the red blood corpuscles, a white liquid will be seen in the top. That is the antisera. In that antisera, you will get lot of molecules like IgG, IgM, IgA, there are many. But 95% of the predominant molecule is the IgG, immunogamma globulin. Okay. And this is the antibody, that's IgG, immunogamma globulin. All would have seen this structure. It's a Y-shaped structure. It has got two light chain, two heavy chain. Okay. And you know, if you have got an FAB fragment, if you do this papain cleavage, and you will get a FAB fragment, and you will get a FC fragment if you do a pepsin cleavage, if you do, you will get a this fragment. Okay. So this is the fragment where your the protein will be having a variable binding structure, and here is the place where the protein will be having binding. Okay. So this is the place for each and every antigen, this will be differing. This is the place it will go and bind. Okay. But this part, you know, this part, it will not react with the antigen or any protein. But this particular part, you know, protein A, have you ever heard about protein A? Protein A. This protein A, which can bind here. So protein A has been exploited to do a variant of ELISA and other things. So this particular part has been exploited to do that. Sometimes even if you cut this with this papain or pepsin, then you can use only this FA fragment. You need not use this particular fragment, fragment of IgG for the diagnostics purpose. And this monoclonal antibody, I was telling about polyclonal antibody. and monoclonal antibody. In monoclonal antibody, you have to inject into the mouse. Okay, the antigen is injected into the mouse. You know, in monoclonal antibody, you need not to have very pure pure form of virus is not needed. Even a partially purified virus, partially purified protein is sufficient to raise a monoclonal antibody, because you have got a screening step where you can take the only one which gives a very specific antibodies. Okay, so you are going to inject into the mouse, or inject into the mouse, you just take the spleen cells. Okay, the spleen you can take where you will get the B cells, where it is producing the, every cells will be producing a particular epitope related this antibodies specific to an epitope. Epitope means it is 7 to 8 amino acids, a stretch of 7 to 8 amino acids, it forms an epitope. In case of polyclonal antibody, there will be hundreds of epitopes. Antibodies will be there for hundreds of epitopes. Okay, it's a mixture of monoclonal antibody only. It's a mixture of monoclonals, it becomes polyclonal. So here also, when you are injecting into the mouse, you are not going to get a monoclonal immediately. You are going to get again polyclonal only. But when you take an individual B cells, it will give you in a single epitope antibodies for a single epitope. Okay, so such cells, B cells, you are going to take from the spleen. Then there is a cells called myeloma cells, that is tumor cells. Tumor cells, it will be it will keep on multiplying on its own, you know, tumor cells. Then you make a fuse it, both tumor cells as well as spleen cells producing the antibodies. Then you get a hybridoma cells. This, once you get a hybridoma cells, you will get that acidic fluids you can make. So hybridoma cells you can screen. You take hundreds of hybridoma cells and screen with your antigen and look for which is giving a very specific high titer reaction. Once you do that testing, which is a good hybridoma for this one, then that hybridoma itself can be injected into the this mouse. The hybridoma cells can be injected again into the mouse. If you are injecting, you acidic fluid it will form. So intraperitoneously, when you are injecting, it will form a acidic fluid. That acidic fluid will have very high titer antibodies you will have. That such antibodies, you know, it will be having 30,000 times you can dilute, 30,000, 50,000 times you can dilute. Whereas polyclonal antisera, you can dilute only 100 times, sometimes 1,000 times, 2,000 times. But monoclonal antibodies, when you do this procedure, finally you get antibodies in the acidic fluid, you will get a good titer. And that you can maintain, you know, you can keep it in a minus 86, you can keep the hybridoma cells. Whenever you want, you take it out, you can thaw, then again you can inject, and again you can multiply, you can in a huge volume, you can multiply and you can take the. So you can, once you develop a monoclonal antibody hybridoma, you can keep as long as 1 or 2 decades also, if you are keeping in a perfect conditions. But polyclonal, once you take, it's that's all. Again, you have to raise. And what you raise in first polyclonal antisera, again, if you are injecting, you may not get the same level. You may not get the same results what you got in the first attempt. After, again, if you are raising once again, it will be differing. Okay, but monoclonal, it's not so. It will be having a repeatable results will be keep on getting from each hybridoma. So this is what gist I have given you here, immunize, and myeloma cells you have to take. You are fusing both myeloma and spleen cells. Once you fuse, you can use PEG and all. Once you fuse, then you clone and screen all those cells which is giving a high titer. Then once you got it, then you can again scale up this one. Then you can do more quantity, you can raise, keep on raising, and you can maintain the culture. Then what is the difference between the polyclonal antibody? Already I have told you, but again, see here it should be, must be pure. In polyclonal antibody, must be pure. If it is not pure, you will get lot of cross reaction. For host protein also, you will be getting cross reaction. So you have to do one more step in the ELISA, that's called cross absorption. I think you might be doing in the practicals. So it should be pure, but whereas here, it need not be pure. You can use a crude antigen preparation also. But only thing is, you have to put more time on screening the monoclonal hybridomas, you have to screen a big level. Okay. Then binding specific epitope, no. But whereas here it binds only a particular specific epitope, only a single epitope. Okay, antibodies is diverse antibodies against different epitopes. Highly specific agonist only one epitope. Then it's a minimum noise. But whereas in polyclonal you will have background noise more. Then production, it's only 2 to 4 months and very low cost. Just around, I think, for 30,000 to 40,000 rupees, there are many outsourcing company. If you give a purified antigen, you will get the polyclonal antibody just for 30,000 to 40,000 rupees. But in case of monoclonal antibodies, it is really 10 times more costlier than raising polyclonal antibodies. Okay. Then lot heterogeneity. Heterogeneity is very high, here it's low. Self-life is limited. Self-life is unlimited in case of monoclonal. And affinity and specificity vary for a given target. Here more vulnerable to loss of epitope through mutation. If that particular epitope is lost through mutation, but it's very rarely occurs, but if a particular epitope is lost, that antibody will not work in monoclonal. So, but it's very rarely happens such mutations because it will be lethal. Sometimes, you know, the mutation will become lethal and some small motif it changes, if it will not transmit. DAG motif, if there is a change, it will not transmit the virus, you know. So it will be lethal to the virus if there are some mutations for some epitopes. Then, you know, nowadays people are not going for a purification of virus. Most of the laboratory, they may not have ultracentrifuge and they don't go because now there are a lot of advantages to do recombinant DNA technology wherein the core protein gene can be cloned and it can be expressed in a bacterial prokaryotic expression you can do. So expressed protein, you will have a very good concentration of the virus and it's a very pure, there won't be any contaminations. So bacterially expressed viral coat proteins can be used to immunize the rabbits to raise a polyclonal antisera or even monoclonal antibodies. Okay, there are good expression systems are available and you know, PET vector has been widely used, maltose binding also, peak cold vector, wherein this vector if you are using, you have to express at 16 degree centigrade. Okay, mostly we used to do at 37 degree centigrade, but this particular peak cold vector if you are using, it expresses protein at low temperature of 16 degree centigrade. Then QIAGEN also has got a series of expression vectors. And while expressing, you have to use a strain where it's engineered strains are there, bacterial strain, like BL21, DE3, Rosetta, yeast and insect. Mostly BL21 bacterial strain is used for expression. Okay. So coming to the techniques, precipitation techniques, though I don't think anyone of you would have done this precipitation technique because it's all outdated. But visibly you can see the precipitation. Okay. What you're seeing here, you know, it's a precipitation. When you mix the antigen and the antibody in a tube like this, a small narrow test tube, very narrow test tube, when you mix it and you allow it for some time, it will form a precipitation. So because the antibodies and the antigen will react and it will show you this type of precipitation and you can see this and you can say positive. But the point is, if you are having a polyclonal antibody, if you do this, if you do 10 experiments, you will lose every antibody. So totally, you have to use a high volume to do this type of experiments. But you know, those days in 1970s, 80s, this was the method. And if you, those days, if you research papers, if you look at, lot many papers were showing this micro precipitin test, tube precipitin test, then micro precipitin test, ring interface test, like there are very many tests where you can visibly see the antigen antibody reaction. Visibly you can see. And this Oxtrelone immunodeficient test, I think every plant pathologist would have read about in the text at least about this. And if you put the anti sera here, you can put antigen or antibody, is either thing you can put it. If you have got many anti sera, you can put it here, put the antigen here and you can identify. But if you want to know, you have got only one particular virus antibodies if you have, you put that antibody and you see all your samples out, wherever it forms this precipitation, this diffusion it goes, it diffuses in the agar and it will form the precipitation, and you will get this type of band, then you can say it is reacting. But again here, it takes a lot of anti-sera, and you need to have to good antigen concentration also, then only you will get. But I think none of you would have seen in either in the practical or anywhere except reading in the textbook, because no one follows these methodologies nowadays. Then agglutination test, but again here it takes only little, okay. And coming to the enzyme linked immunosorbent assay, in 1977 Clark and Adams, when they published a paper wherein they used double antibody sandwich ELISA, it was very interesting, and there are thousands and thousands of research papers was published using in both animal, human and plant viruses using this ELISA technique to quantify. See, in ELISA technique you can do qualitatively, you can do, and also you can do it quantitatively, how much virus is there or not, you can quantify in ELISA. But it's not possible in other techniques, but in ELISA you can do it. And ELISA is such a wonderful technique, you can do minimum 50 viruses you can test at a time if you have got antibodies, because you use microturbinated plate having 96 wells, you can use different antisera, different antigen you can target and do this. And very low volume, you can just have 100 microliter, it's very low volume, antigen is sufficient. You do not have to crush, you just crush 100 milligram of leaf samples and test it, you can get the result. And as I said, it's a qualitative or quantitative, you need not to have an ELISA reader. You need not to have ELISA reader to say whether it is positive or negative. See, it's yellow color, it's say it's a positive in case of alkaline phosphatase if you are using. Or if you are using other enzyme substrate constant, this one, the color varies, and you can visibly see, say it's a positive or negative, okay. You need not have always a ELISA reader. If you want to quantify, then you need to have an ELISA reader, otherwise you need not to have. Then of course it is inexpensive. When we say it's an inexpensive, we compare with acetylene diffusion test, tube precipitation test. When you compare all these things, this is cheaper, okay. Otherwise ELISA also is now, it's costlier than the technique which we have now. Then a basic ELISA protocol, I think being all of you are a plant pathologist, you would have handled an ELISA plate, how to do an ELISA you would have done. Even then I would like to say, in ELISA plate, you know, microrotator plate, it's a polystyrene coated. If you are loading any protein, it will bind, any protein it will bind, okay. So your a sample, a leaf sample, you just crush it, a crude leaf sample, put in a posit buffer, any buffer, a kind of buffer you can take, and crush it, and just to put that crude sample, all the proteins it will bound into the ELISA plate, okay. Then you block the remaining binding sites using a solid base, because the protein which you have put initially may be very low concentration, so there will be many places where it will be unbound area will be there. So in such unbound area, without doing a blocking those sites, if you go for antibody, the next step is adding an antibody that will go and bind, and it will give the background noise. So a blocking step is always added, and in blocking steps you can use any, is it light? No, is it coming up? In blocking step, so yeah, in blocking step, what we are doing is those unbound region, in unbound region we are putting a unrelated protein, so it goes and blocks there, okay. Then wash out excess reagent. You know, washing is a step I think would have all done. There are machines now, it will do automatic washing, but you can also do washing with a different kind of way, using a squeeze bottle and PBST with the tween you put and wash, and again you had to remove all those unbound proteins. Then after washing, you put the, finally you had to add a conjugate with alkaline phosphatase, or there are many horseradish peroxidase, you can use it, and you put the substrate, then you will get the color change. So this color change can be visibly seen, or it can be, you can see the limit that you can also quantify the color, and you can relate with the concentration. And which format you want to use and all, I think I am going to deal about different format, direct antigen and direct ELISA, indirect ELISA. There are different formats, and mostly what we use is DOC ELISA, direct antigen coding ELISA is the one which you can do very fast. When you're doing DOS ELISA, double antibody sandwich ELISA, it is very specific and it takes a little more time, but it's very specific one. And different kind you can see, whether you have got a monoclonal, whether you have got a polyclonal, or whether you have got a more than 2-3 different antibodies, then you can go for a triple antibody sandwich ELISA also. So there are different formats. Based on the availability you can decide a format, and based on the need you can decide a format. For a routine diagnostics like in quarantine or anywhere for seed testing and all, they go for direct antigen coding ELISA, and it takes only 4 to 5 hours. If you do DOS ELISA, it takes 7 to 8 hours. Okay. So these are the different formats you can see. It's a direct ELISA, wherein the antigen is first coated, then primary antibody conjugate. Directly you can put the conjugate. Directly you can put the conjugate. Conjugate means an antibody linked with an enzyme. It's a conjugate. So this antigen, this antibody specific to this antigen, then put this antibody conjugated one and add the substrate. So only two steps you can do this. Then otherwise you can do indirectly. In indirectly means this particular antibody, the secondary antibody what we call, is not related to the antigen. That's what we call it's indirect. Okay? So we put antigen, then we put antibody specific to this antigen, then antibody to antibody we use. Antibody to antibody. So if you are having antibody raised in the rabbit, that antibody you take and inject into the mice or goat and raise an antibody. So anti-rabbit antibody you take from other animal, that is this, and you do a conjugate and we add the substrate, you will get it. This is indirect. So whenever we are not using the related antibody to the antigen, it's called indirect. Wherever using the same homologous antibody, then it's a direct. That's the only one thing. But the formats are different. Okay. Again, this is indirect, wherein we are using the again secondary antibody. Here we are using three antibodies. The first one we are using a capture antibody. Sometimes the virus concentration will be very, very less in the plant. You can capture using a polyclonal antibody raised in rabbit. We have raised in a rabbit for this antigen, it is reacting. And again, you have also raised an antibody in goat, let us say. So then you can use again here. Then anti-goat antibody you can raise and you can have conjugate, then you do this. So here, almost three antibodies are present, raised in three different animals. Okay, so this is, and then competitive. So there are different formats. And indirect ELISA, as I was telling, already I told you about clearly that the purpose for which we are doing is more important. Routine testing you can do direct ELISA, but if you want to do specific, DOS ELISA is better. And if you again you want to do low titer, you go for triple antibody sandwich ELISA. That will give low titer viruses can be detected. Okay, so this is direct ELISA. I think already I told you. This is antibody sandwich ELISA, wherein we are using three different antibodies. Then this is triple antibody sandwich ELISA. I was telling you three different kinds of antibodies are used here. Then protein A sandwich ELISA. You know, I said I was telling you protein A can bind to the Fc region of the antibodies. That can be exploited for this purpose, and it gives more sensitivity. It gives more sensitivity. So protein A molecule also can be used. Protein A sandwich ELISA can be done. Then if you want to see, there are many problems will come when you do ELISA. Background, sometimes you may not get good results. So there are a lot of troubleshooting one has to do as a pathologist, as a diagnostics. You must know why, what is the problem, how it is happening, and how these things you have to do, able to troubleshoot. Okay. So for that, we have to see the background noise can usefully be minimized by optimizing the blocking and washing steps. Washing steps and blocking is more important. Then testing different plates. Sometimes, you know, if you use a kind of plates, you know, we have got different, in the market you get different kinds of plates. And each manufacturer has got different quality of the plates. So you have to try with the different types of plates and do, you will get different result. I mean, result in the sense, the sensitivity will be differing based on the plates also. Then because the polystyrene is coating, you know, that differs from company to company. So if you take a Nunk plate, it will be different. If you take a Torsen Elisa plate, it will have a different. Okay. Then the colorimetric or chemiluminescent. Normally what we do is colorimetric, but you can also do chemiluminescent. And if you do chemiluminescent, you will increase the sensitivity. Then you can go increasing the incubation time. Sometimes half an hour is sufficient. Sometimes 2 hours incubation at 37 degrees centigrade will give a better result. So these things you have to do. Then ideal blocking agent, you know, that's very important. Otherwise you will get even a negative also. False positive, false negative you get if you are not using. So bovine serum albumin is widely used, non-fat dried milk, normal serum, casein, the different protein, unrelated protein can be used. But if these protein, if an antibody, especially monoclonal antibody, if you while using, these blocking reagents may react sometimes. So you have to choose which blocking is better, which blocking reagent is better. So again, if you, there are five key issues, causes you can see, that's insufficient blocking, insufficient plate washing, cross-reactivity, primary, secondary and conjugate antibody concentration if it is too high, then incubation time is excessive for your sample, antibodies or substrate. These are all different things. So if you are working with a new, you want to develop a serological assay for a particular virus, you never have any such research papers on that, then you have to do all this sort of standardization. Okay. So the concentration of antibody and concentration of coating antibody, all this you have to take into consideration. Normally once we get a result, we are happy and we just forget it. But unless you had to do each and every step, if you want to take into a commercial level, if you want to take, you have to see all these concentrations. Okay. Then again, when you are using alkaline phosphatase, widely used. But you know, if you are using horse radish peroxidase, it gives you a very good sensitivity than alkaline phosphatase. But the thing is, it's, you have to act timely. Within few minutes, you will get the reaction. If you are just missing that, your entire experience goes in vain if you are using HRP. But alkaline phosphate is stable for a long time, you need not to bother. But HRP gives more sensitivity, so you should be careful there. And there are different substrates widely used actually. In alkaline phosphatase, you know, paranitrophenyl phosphate, NPP, is used. There are other, 5-bromo-4-chloro-3-indolyl phosphate. For insoluble reaction, dot immunobinding assay, we use this with the NBT, nitroblue tetrazolium, as well as 5-bromo-chloro. This, if you do, you will get an insoluble, this one. So we can use it in the dot format, not in a liquid ELISA format. So horse radish peroxidase, we have got a lot of substrates we have got. The one widely used is gives you blue color, this TMB, it gives you the blue color. This blue color, when you add a stopping solution, if you add H2SO4, then it will become yellow color. That yellow color you have to read at 450. Otherwise, that blue color you have to read at 650 nanometer. So you have to stop the reaction and you will get yellow color. That yellow color is read at different nanometer, 450 nanometer, and you can quantify. I think most of our plant pathology diagnostics of plant viruses, HRP is not widely used in laboratory level. Then I would skip these slides. The factors that affect the ELISA against signal generation also, as already I have told you, the plate and coating or different buffer, everything I have told you. Then comes the dot immunobinding assay. This is a wonderful technique. And you know, here you just dot your sample, sent to USA or sent to anywhere, any laboratory where they can do it. You spot your antigen and just send it. Then the rest can be done in any laboratory. So this is a wonderful technique, dot immunobinding assay, to do indexing. Then tissue blot immunoassay is widely practiced, and wherein you need not use any buffer. Just take a infected tissue or suspected plant tissue, just blot it and do, and you can get the results. But you know, sometimes you will get even any like banana tissues, if you take and make a tissue, you will get a brownish color because of antioxidants and phenolics. You will get, you cannot differentiate between this tissue naturally what you get the color and with this positive and you cannot distinguish. And wherein here you have to use sometimes some additives so that you can avoid such colors. Then Western blot, you know, Western blot diagnostic purpose rarely being used, but while screening the antibody, anti-sera and all, you can do a Western blot. You can be very sure that the antibody reacts or not with the antigen. You can make sure in this Western blot technique. Then immunosorbent electron microscopy, Dr. Pant was telling a few days back. And you know, once whether your anti-sera is really working or not, you can visibly see under electron microscope when you do the decoration technique, and you will get a wonderful the decorated particle. And you would have seen in, I think this is from Matthew's book in 1993, that book if you see what a wonderful coating. See, unrelated virus, there are no coating at all. So you get visibly, you see whether your antibody is reacting or coating the virus or not, you can visibly see. Okay. So like isometric particle, you see those unrelated virus, it will not react. So your quality of your antibody is good or not, you can see under ISEM technique, immunosorbent electron microscopy, where decoration is used. Then that's what, immunogold electron microscopy, this is all now routinely people are not using, you know, but you can see the gold particles which is bound with the antibody, gold is bound with the antibody, then you see the decoration, you can spot it sometimes, okay. So then immunocapture polymerase chain reaction, you know, this is very widely used now. Why? Because most of the DNA viruses are very, very less titer, and they use first capture the virus, then do this PCR, then you get it. But otherwise you do regular routinely PCR, you may not get positive reaction even in infected plant. So that is to this is a combining both immuno and polymerase reaction. Then immunoprecipitin polymerase reaction is also more or less same. Then coming to the lateral flow immunoassay, this is the one which you know, pregnancy test, this was some 30 years back, 3 decades back this was introduced. Within a few minutes, one can say a urine sample by testing, 5 minutes you can say whether pregnant or not a patient, you can immediately tell. Here, we have developed in Banana also a dipstick assay. Within 3 to 5 minutes you can say the given sample is having virus or not. So anywhere a farmer can use it. A citrus farmer, let us say, he has got a plant, that tree of 10 years old tree, whether it has got a virus or not, he himself can test using a dipstick. And say in human and animal virologists, they use point of care diagnostics where this dipstick is widely used to diagnose the whether virus is there or not. Okay. So this is very interesting, and where you need not, a pathologist need not to do this test. Anyone can do this test, and you know, just to see reading the what to do, the step by step, immediately one can do this very simple test. And the principle you might be knowing about. If you don't know, I'll just let you tell here. In conjugate, what we call conjugate enzyme, IgG is conjugated with an enzyme, you know, here we conjugate with a gold, nano gold particle, that's all. If nanogold particle joins together, more number of nanogold particle comes together, you can visibly see a color. Okay, you can visibly see a color. That's what you see here. So here, the antibody is coated with colloidal gold. Okay, colloidal gold nanoparticle, you can combine. Okay, then here antibody, you can coat it here, and you can put goat anti-rabbit IgG. So this IgG would be reacting with this actually. So test line, control line you have to have, and this is an absorbent pad, and this is a sample pad. Sample pad and absorbent pad. In absorbent pad, it will pull actually. Lateral flow happens because of the quality of the absorbent pad. So once you put a sample, if it contains virus, it will be moving, it will react with the antibody. If that particular virus is there in this sample, it will move laterally, it will react, and it will take along with the antibody conjugated with gold. it will move and it will be reacting with the test line because there is an antibody we have already coated there. So it will form a line which is visible to the naked eye. Then comes to the control, those which are all not bound, it will further move and it will be reacting with this because it is antibody raised against an IgG. That's what it reacts in the control line. So if there is no virus, it will not react in the test line. Further it will move, it will be reacting with the control line. But always in the control line, there will be a line. If control line, if it is there only, you can say this strip is working. Otherwise, this strip is not working. So you will get a line like this in test line as well as control line you will get. Of course, there are a lot of steps are there to do standardization, how much the antibody you had to coat, how many antibody you had to print on the NCM. These things, a lot of standardization parts is there. So like this you can do, and here you know there are poly bags wherein you can put a leaf sample, just crush it without touching anything. You can crush it, you will get a sap, and you just dip that strip here and you will get, within few minutes you will get this color which is visibly seen. And this is widely used in citrus and many other crops. This type of test is used for diagnosis. So this advantage is, as I said, it's a in-field or on-site diagnostics. Any illiterate person can use this technique, and it's very cheap compared to ELISA. It is cheap again. Per strip, it costs only 50 to 100 rupees. But whereas in ELISA, the cost goes to 200 rupees. And if you look at the detection limit of different protein-based techniques, you can see the techniques. See, in ELISA, you can detect even 1 to 10 nanogram of virus you can detect. In ELISA, you know, in case of on-site diagnostic, the dipstick, it's only qualitative. Yes or no, you can say. But you cannot quantify the virus in case of dipstick. Okay? But in ELISA, you can quantify. So different techniques are there. Of course, the widely used technique is ELISA only at present for the routine diagnostics. Then this microspore immunoassay is very interesting, you know, this. It's a patented technology actually, this microspore immunoassay. They use magnetic microspore. Every spore, it has got a different color, and it will be absorbed by a different wavelength. And you can, this is like a barcode, okay. These microspheres are like a barcode. This, you can choose any of the beads and conjugate your antibody with specific to a particular virus. Okay, that you can keep it, and you add your sample. Once you are adding your sample, it will bind. So while samples are binding, there will be excess. Using a magnetic, this one, you can remove it. Using a magnetic, the bead will be absorbed. The excess unbound proteins or antigen can be easily washed out. Then again, you can add, you can do this again with specific to the virus, you can add it. So finally, you can put here more than hundreds of virus you can do at a time. In a single experiment, more than 100 virus you can do, different virus, different antibody. The only thing is, we have to have antibody and we have to have the antigen. 100 at a time you can do it, and such a good one. Of course, the cost is very high. In India, there are few machines are there in some laboratories, this particular machine, because it has got a different light and other things to identify the beads and other things. It needs a laser technology. See what you are seeing here. To what kind of bead it is having, you can use a red laser you can use. And you can see what kind of antibodies which is joined with or phycoerythrin labeled antibodies, that you can use phycoerythrin, that will be exciting, and this emission can be read in another laser. So this particular machine can detect both the magnetic beads having a different light emission, and again, this phyco or phycoerythrin labeled specific antibodies also can be read. And in a mixer, you can identify 50 different types of antigens or virus. You can do it. It can be a fungal, it can be a bacterial, it can be anything, you can, any kind of things. The point is, this particular machine is widely used in the cancer biology. There are hundreds of biomarkers are available for cancer detection, and this is widely used. And a very few research papers have come detecting the plant viruses recently. But otherwise, it's widely used in the cancer detection, where many biomarkers can be targeted in a given point of time. Okay. So I have already told about the strength and limitations of the serological assays, which is protein based. And when you definitely when you talk about genome targeted and protein based, genome targeted are more sensitive, but not high throughput. And we have to have always instrument, you know, and a PCR machine is needed, and a very good technical knowledge is needed when you are doing a genome targeted. And in genome targeted, all you know, a mutation can occur. A single mutation, single change in a nucleic acid, a base cannot make that PCR negative. But in protein, it's not so. In protein-based diagnostics, even there is a change in the a single amino acid, it can able to detect. But in case of nucleic acid targeted, a single base change, if you have got a primer ending, 3' end of a primer, is there is a change, then you will not get amplification. So this is very common, you know, in case of cucumber mosaic virus, banana streak virus, there are many viruses, it keeps on changing its mutating. You know, it will be a lot of mutations happens, PCR based diagnostic fails, and you have to have always the sequence, you have to do sequencing to find out whether such mutations has happened, whether such mutants are surviving, whether that mutants are lethal, or the advantage to the virus, some mutation happens. So nucleic acid based diagnosis is more sensitive, but at same time it's vulnerable for mutation and you will end up with no detection. But whereas serological based, you can do high throughput, you can handle large number of samples at a given point of time. So this is protein based diagnostics is quite good for many certification programs and other purpose. And there are a few slides about our NRC Barana where we have done some work that I am going to tell you. So for cucumber mosaic virus, we took the viral code protein and we expressed and we got the antibodies. We developed a dot immuno, this ELISA based diagnostics, and we also developed a dipstick assay for cucumber mosaic virus of banana. Then banana bract mosaic virus, this paper is going to come in Journal of Virological Methods. Here also banana bract mosaic virus, we raised the anti-sera. We expressed in the bacterial expression system. Then we raised a very good antisera, and recently we came out with a monoclonal antibodies, and we developed a dipstick. It's a quite wonderful dipsticks, and within 2 to 3 minutes you get a result. And in fact, this was released by our honorable agriculture minister in one of the ICAR foundation day. This kit, and this kit we are going to commercialize in India. That is banana bract mosaic virus dipstick kit. And we have also done for banana streak Mysore virus. This is published in Journal of Phytopathology. And we expressed this viral associated protein. It's not a code protein. There is a protein coded by banana streak Mysore virus which interacts with the genome. So this we have expressed antibody. And you know why we could not go for code protein? Because even today, code protein is not characterized in case of banana streak virus till date. So we went for this viral associated protein and we raised the antibody and we got a very good reproducible result in the ELISA. And we did DOS ELISA using that antibody, DOC ELISA. Then you can see this decoration of bullet shaped particle of banana streak virus. And we have also used immunocapture PCR for this. And it's working wonderfully to detect the banana streak badenovirus. Then we have also done for banana bunchitov virus. Again, banana bunchitov virus, ELISA based is very tough. So what we did was we expressed the replicase initiation protein gene. And we got a 34 kDa protein and we have raised antibodies. And we are developing a dipstick based on this. And when you see, there are a lot of experiments to be done to find which serological method is better. So you see, our dot immunobinding as a colorimetric, regularly what we use BCIP and NBT, and you get this color. And you can also use chemiluminescent. Chemiluminescent and again insoluble, that is nearly 10 to 100 times more sensitive. You can use. And amplified ELISA, that is another. Then NPP, nitro blow, this ELISA, routine ELISA also can be done, can be used. This Thomason gearing from Queensland Institute of Technology, University, they have developed an ELISA where triple antibodies have used for bunchitop. Even today, detecting a banana bunchitop virus using ELISA is a very toughest task, since it occurs very, very low concentration, and furthermore, it is a phloem bound. So phloem bound viruses are very difficult to detect by ELISA or serological technique. Then applications, as I said, it can be used for detection, then survey, disease monitoring, epidemiological studies, quarantine, breeding programs, and certification programs. Very, very important is certification programs. Then different applications are there. In certification programs, we have done for banana quite a good service we have done for national certification system for tissue culture raised plant, wherein we were part almost 1.5 decade we were working on this in testing. We tested 295 million plants we have from our laboratory. We have certified 295 million tissue culture banana plants from our laboratory using our indigenous serological kit, what we developed at our laboratory at National Research Center for Banana. And hill banana, you might be knowing, which is very prone for banana bunchitop virus, and it has got a GI tag, that's called Virupakshi banana. And this particular banana, we developed a diagnostic kit and we got virus-free plants supplied to a tissue culture company, and they supplied around 10 lakh plants. We replaced all infected with a healthy plants. Now, the hill banana, if you go, you will get a virus-free hill banana in Lower Palani Hills of Tamil Nadu. So we could able, through diagnostics, we could be able to save this near extinct banana, elite banana clone in India, and we could able to achieve in a decade of our work. Now you get a virus-free hill banana plants in Tamil Nadu. And as I said, quite a good progress has happened in banana under NCSTCP. Then, in application point of view, in United States, you know, they use in California and Florida and all, they use for different program, the application, in most of which they use serological method. Now they combine PCR also, but they never gave up the serological approach to do the diagnosis. So they combine both genome targeted as well as serological to do the certification. Similarly, for citrus, they do always they do both the serological as well as genome based test. In case of European and Mediterranean Plant Protection Organization, this is the protocol they applied to ensure CTV free plants. Then all of you know about seed potato certification. It's widely used, and you know, it's very, very very important tuber crop, wherein multiple 20 to 25 viruses are there in potato. And indexing, getting a virus-free seed potato is very important. In our central CPRA, Central Potato Registration, they have done a wonderful work. Here at our plant virology unit also has done wonderful work. So this is one of the applications of our protein-based diagnostics. And here again, PCR-based diagnostics will not work such a high throughput level. So they depend always on serological based diagnosis. Then finally, I would say that serological based methods are very robust and easily adopted in any environment. With little technical knowledge, the protein based technique can be used for routine detection of viruses in planting material, especially clonally propagated banana, sugarcane, potato, and the citrus. Clonally propagated crops, you can use it. To ensure virus-free planting material, high throughput method of choice would be serological rather nucleic acid. And mutations in the viral genome may lead to the failure in nucleic acid-based method, but not in serological. The ELISA and LFIA, that is dipstick, are available from many private firms in easy-to-use forms for on-site or point-of-care diagnosis. Then on-site detection of viruses by any illiterate grower is possible within the DeepStack, which are readily available in the markets now. So what I was telling is we have developed two DeepStacks, but there are a lot of DeepStacks available in the commercially in Agdi and many other companies, and that is widely used in diagnostics in for to diagnosing many viruses. And with this, I thank you for your patience. If you have any questions, you can feel free to ask me.
Can we use, just like we are developing the cocktail ELISA, can we use that kind of cocktail ELISA in these DeepStack lateral flow immunoassay so that we can detect more than one virus in one go?
Yeah, of course. It's not that at the time one virus as you perceived. Actually, you can detect more number of virus in a single strip. Let us say potato virus, they have developed four viruses in a single strip you can detect. And in banana virus also, we have combined for both cucumber mosaic virus and bragg mosaic virus in a single strip.
Yes,
it can be detected, multiple virus can be detected in a single strip.
Okay.
It is very much possible.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, thank you, sir, for such a wonderful speech.